Hey, welcome to The History of Being Human. This is Noel Armstrong. As I said in my recent message, I won't be producing any major episodes until March, but if I get the time, I might drop a couple of interviews that I did earlier. This interview is one of those. It is a little bit tragic because this could have been and should have been one of my best interviews ever. I'm speaking with Dr. Vera Tiesler, the foremost expert on ancient American ritual sacrificial practices. At the time I spoke to her, I wasn't very familiar with her work or even her name. But after I spoke to her, about a year later, in April of 2020, research done by Vera and her co-author, Guillaume Olivier, dropped like a bomb on the anthropological community. And in fact, it was interesting and sensationalist enough that it was picked up by mainstream news sources. And Vera became, frankly, famous. She was interviewed on NPR and other mass media venues. That research documented three separate ways that the Mayan priests would extract the heart from their victims, either by cutting right through the sternum, separating the ribs, cutting between the ribs, or going in under the ribs. So you see, I had this interview with Vera sitting on my hard drive, but the tragedy is this. The audio quality is terrible. I'm speaking with Vera while she's in the Yucatan, and I don't know what the connection problem was, but it sounds terrible. And I'm just going to be honest with you, that's not even the worst of it. Because of the delays and a little bit of a language barrier, the content of the interview is a little disjointed. I've tried to clean it up. I've tried to reduce the noise. But frankly, it's still hard to listen to. And it was hard to sit through, in fact, while I was doing it, so I cut it short early because of that. So I apologize for the poor audio quality. But if you want to hear from one of the foremost experts in ancient Mesoamerican human sacrificial practices, that's Vera Tiesler. That's why it's an honor to have her on my podcast at all. Grateful for her time giving this interview, and I really wish the audio quality had been better. So with that little caveat auditor, if you are an audiophile, if you like high-quality sound, if you're sensitive to poor sound quality, this is not the interview for you. But if you are interested in hearing from one of the foremost experts in her field in the world, then I leave with you this interview with Vera Tiesler. Hello, Dr. Tiesler?
Yes.
Are you in the Yucatan right now?
Right now, yes. What is your podcast exactly about? I understand it's a series about human nature, human experiences, and this forms you want to have this as part of it.
So really, it's a history podcast as it started. My stated goal in the podcast is to learn who we are by looking at what we've done.
Yeah, I think we have similar backgrounds, in fact. I studied medicine, too, and then I switched to anthropology, and I'm quite happy with the bioarch.
I saw that you were, 5 years in medical training?
Yeah, right, between Germany and Mexico. By coincidence, right now, my main focus is human sacrifice, so I was kind of eager to take your talk.
I've been captivated for a long time by Mayan ruins. First, because I was raised to think that the Mayans were a lost tribe of Israel. But then as I became a little bit more acquainted with them, I became interested in them for their own right. I've had a chance to visit Tulum, Coba, and of course Chichen Itza, and just been mystified and captivated by the ruins. So as I was researching for this podcast, I feel very privileged to come across the work of a PhD anthropologist at the National Autonomous University of Mexico, in Mérida, a recognized expert in Mayan ritual, Mayan culture, Mayan practice. She has collaborated on many volumes, both as editor and writer. So it's a great honor, and I'm very happy to welcome Dr. Tiesler to the podcast. Dr. Tiesler, thank you for being here.
Hi. I work here in the Yucatan, right in the heart of the Maya area. I'm coordinating here a lab on bioarchaeology. That's a term that sounds a little bit enigmatic, but it does not mean anything else but working with human remains from a bioculturalist perspective as part of archaeology in order to provide what I would call it a human perspective to the past, in this case, to the ancient Maya.
Now, I understand you're from Germany. So how did you end up in the Yucatan?
Well, it's a long and short story. Most of my education I received here in Mexico although I'm also a Tulane, where I did my BA degree in art history, majoring in art history. But mainly being here in Mesoamerica and studying anthropology and archaeology was exactly what was my dream. And I am quite happy that I can work in this field, combining it with my education as an MD, a medical doctor. So that's why I combine in my approaches a lot of anatomy, forensics, and of course, cosmology and anthropology focused on this area.
And I think that's an interesting arc. Were you considering going into the practice of medicine originally and then found yourself drawn to anthropology, or did you always know anthropology was it for you and that medicine would inform that?
Well, my dad was a medical doctor, and he, since I didn't have like a clear picture of what I wanted to go into, my father said, well, why don't you just study medicine and then do whatever you want afterwards, because it's so useful. And I did exactly that. I could never figure myself being a consultant or being, you know, in a regular 9-to-5 job. So I chose research as my vein of focus of my working vision and passion. And that has worked out in the most unusual way you can imagine. But I'm quite happy that I'm able to do what I am, and I'm well off working from the Yucatan.
I think it's interesting how your medical training's played into your work. I see you've done some work on head shaping practices, dental decorations, and so forth, which the forensic background would certainly be helpful in.
Absolutely. And not only this background, but being eager on collaborating with interdisciplinary research teams from Mexico and abroad, this has helped a lot. And of course, it brings together teams, it brings together expertise, and opens like thinking. It makes you think out of the box. And I think doing bioarchaeology from this combined perspective gives you so much insight, not only into the anatomies or into populations, but also into the human nature.
So Dr. Tiesler, a lot of your research is focused on the Mayan culture and ritual practices. So let's start with a very basic question. Who were the Maya?
Well, the Maya were many, many, many people. It's a cultural landscape that is as diverse as complex, and they by themselves form part of the greater Mesoamerican cultural spheres, which breaches thousands of kilometers and 5 to 6 countries. So what held these folks together? It was a combined history, string of history. They are a language group, and of course, they have a host of beliefs and practices that are common, such as, for example, the notion that they had to nurture their gods. They had to feed their gods.
This may be a strange question, but I want to know who the Maya thought they were. And what I mean by that is, so if you ask a 21st century European, who are you? They'd say, well, we're a culture-bearing, large-brained ape. Or they might say, we're a creation of God, or, you know, something like that. But who did the Maya think they were?
Oh, actually, I don't think they felt themselves as Maya. They would feel like, oh, I'm Tzotzil, oh, I am Yucatecan, oh, I am Chorti, abiding by the language group. This construction, this academic construction of the Maya, or today's Maya, that's broadly, I think, artificial.
When did their civilization flourish? When did it rise? When was the classic era, and when did it decline?
The first signs of life we have way back, many thousands years ago. A recent finding from close to Tulum confirms that, where a female youngster was found that is dated to 13,000 years ago. Naya, she was called. But when did the Maya emerge into this picture? We're talking about 4,000 years ago. They fostered a way of thinking that was aligned with the Olmec, the called mother civilization of Mesoamerica. And then they spin into their own political social dynamic towards the age of Jesus Christ. That's when first kingdoms arose in the central lowland Mayas, and there was a population increase, intensification. And so we're talking about maybe 50 different kingdoms, small and large, during the first millennium AD. Then most people know this could not be sustained. The Maya kingdoms collapsed. and gave rise to the late era hallmarked by Chichen Itza, Mayapan, and other kingdoms that were much aligned with the Aztecs in the late post-classic until during the early 16th century, the Spaniards arrived and Mesoamerican civilization came to an abrupt end.
Did I hear you correctly saying 13,000 years ago?
Yes, right. But we're not talking about Maya, of course, the initial migration into the American continent. The detailed case study of these individuals gives so much more information about specialization or non-specialization, about the style of living, about family structures. I mean, that's very much enriching. And we can say the population was much, much before the Maya came into the picture, of course.
All growing up, I was told that the Aztecs were the violent, bloodthirsty, human-sacrificing people, and the Maya were the peaceful, one-with-nature type of tribes. And yet all that changed, and I don't think that's currently the opinion anymore.
Absolutely not, but I think you're right in one assertion, which has to do with the Aztecs. I'm sure that the Aztecs brought ritualized and politically motivated violence to one extreme, and I think there's no discussion about it. The classic period Maya, their existence was 400 years before the Aztecs really came into the picture. There's a debate going on between the Central American, or the better to say the Central Mexican influence in the dawning of the new era, the new post-classic era in Chichen, and I think it was probably much more complex and probably vice versa. There has been a lot of proposal about the Tula-Chichen connection, and this was probably, most probably, part of a broader cosmological change that had its origins much earlier. But what we can see in both places, Chichen Itza and before the Puuc area and in the central highlands, is an increase in violence and different god emblems that motivate such form of violence. And there's certainly a massification of death. Ritualized death.
So many of us have seen the movie Apocalypto. Have you seen that?
Yes.
And so my first question, you know, related to the human sacrifice aspect, how accurate is that movie?
Oh, I think they had it all wrong. I found this movie pretty much appalling.
More Mel Gibson and torture porn.
Right. It was well done, but the contents were pretty much off and really unrespectful. I was really surprised because the movie was so well made to see that the string of action was so far from what really should have happened or would be culturally aligned that, well, that was a bad surprise.
What do we know about the Mayan practice of human sacrifice or bloodletting?
I think the Maya are just in line with other Mesoamerican folks in that they had a notion of merit-making towards the gods. Mesoamerican societies foster a pantheon of gods. There are many gods that represent different aspects of nature, not only the terrestrial nature, but also the celestial nature, different aspects like water, fire, so forth. They are kind of natural powers that had to be venerated. And how were they venerated? They were really conceived to be in the need of being fed, of being nurtured. And that's exactly what people did to honor their gods. So not only did they sacrifice animals, they sacrificed food staples, they would donate fragrances, they would donate clouds, they would donate essences of what you would call materials to their gods. And different gods had different necessities, different calendar dates to be honored, and of course different needs in terms of being fed.
What motivates people to sacrifice in general? Is it the fact that they enjoy themselves receiving a gift that costs somebody something, and so they figure the gods would be the same? I've often wondered what instigated the whole practice of sacrificing, whether it's grains or animals or people.
Well, I think one has to be clear on one thing, that human sacrifice is one big extreme of a whole scope of ritual practices. And human sacrifice was practiced most probably only in the central urban strongholds of the kingdom elites, the aristocratic elites. And it comes along with political appropriation and hierarchy, social hierarchy. So what we see in terms of the iconography, in terms of the material evidence, is very, very tied to those extremes. So one has to be clear on that, I think. And in those circles that did practice human sacrifice, I think we have to be very careful not to underestimate the ritual choreographies, the norms. These were highly conservative practices that were performed in strict liturgy, so to speak, and in accordance with a whole set of other ritual practices. So I think one has to see this not as an isolated phenomenon, but as an integral part of something much broader.
So how was it done? How were these sacrifices? How was this liturgical practice enacted?
Well, one form of sacrifice, you brought this up, is the self-sacrifice. There were different forms of feeding the gods by the own essence, the essences of self. One is by donating blood in different forms. Not only the priests did that, but also youngsters, kids, depending on the occasion, also women, like a very heterogeneous form of merit doing with the gods that we do not quite understand in its full breach and in terms of the occasions that we do understand, we do know from the Aztecs, for example. We have the notion that this was a daily practice. It had to do a lot with calendar rites, with certain occasions that were honoring certain natural powers. And, well, they were quite widespread. Not as widespread as human sacrifice, and that had different venues of expression. Human sacrifice can be motivated, for example, by commemorative event, by terminating events, by certain calendar rites, which are nothing but ending one cycle and opening, well, another cycle. There are propitiatory sacrifices that, for example, want to bring rain. Religious sacrifice in general has to be in benefit of the broader society. You cannot have religious sacrifice just to benefit one person. So in the academics, we usually do not speak of religiously motivated sacrifice when we talk about container death, container killings. These are prestigious killings that were destined to celebrate, for example, the enthronement of a ruler or the death of a ruler. So we have to tear those apart.
What do you mean by prestigious?
These prestigious killings were destined to help the ruler in its cycling after past death, for example. So they're clearly in place in the benefit of one sector, in the benefit of one person. Which also, at the same time, underlines the big differences, social differences that existed, the complete lack of care for a life of a container individual that was sacrificed, that was killed, just to facilitate the cycling of a dynastic elite person. So it tells you about the hierarchy of those societies.
You've used the term container individual. What is a container individual?
It's an individual that is killed to accompany a ruler or any other person of the elite in his or her resting place. Accompany this person past death.
Okay. I saw something about this ball game, and it was motivated by the Popol Vuh, and they're the hero twins that played against some of the gods of the underworld. Does that play into some of the practices of human sacrifice in Mayan culture?
Absolutely, and most certainly into the post-classic, the late ways that included sacrifice. As you know, the ball court, the pre-Hispanic ball game, was not only sportive, but it was closely aligned with religious purposes and the religious calendar. So the ball play would be a metaphor of the world, and the ball would symbolize the movements of the sun. In turn, this movement had to be propelled, and for this purpose, again, it was not only the ball game, but it was also the game of life. It was donation of life. It was the donation of the players, that we're feeding the sun and we're propelling the cosmos, so to speak. So ball games are closely associated with ritual human sacrifices that were performed notably, for example, in Chichen Itza, where they are also represented on the friezes that align the ball courts by decapitation. We have a reminder of the quantity of victims that were most probably sacrificed on those occasions in the form of the tsompantli that lines the ball court at Chichen Itza and most probably was there in place to sustain a platform, a skull platform of several hundred, most probably thousands of skulls.
Wow. So these ball games were not just a sporting event. They were some sort of reenactment of a cosmic struggle followed by a religious ceremony of decapitation.
Not only decapitation, but some sort of donation of human essences in the form of heads or more so of human hearts. By the scrutiny of forensic evidence, we have a notion of how this was performed and what happened afterwards. The victim was in some occasions decapitated at first to irrigate with his or her blood the earth. This was part of a concerted choreography that was most probably presided by a priest and played out in the public. And at least talking about Chichen and huge public places that, are part of the public architecture in this center. And then the ritual sequence, went on past death. The donations of human essences, for example, the blood, the heart, was donated in public in the terms of burning it or donating it or smearing the blood on the mouths of the deity representations in stone. And the victim itself was subject often to further processing in the terms of flaying, leaving the skin off, taking the skin off, the exposure of the heads, of the flayed heads on public racks, and then further on the defleshing of the victims.
So this sounds horrible. Who were these unfortunate victims?
Well, it may be sounding theatrical or pathetic, but these victims were dying the most honorable death, if we believe the Aztecs. It was the death that shortcut their cycling through the womb of the earth to accompany directly the stars, the sun, in its daily tour above the earth, in their own terms. So the appropriation of the different essences, material essences, the flesh and the bones, etc., of these victims, they were there to nurture the nature, to nurture the cosmos. So it was a most honorable death. Unfortunately for the victims, these were their mostly exterior, not from inside, but from conquistas, from conquerors.
It sounds almost like you're describing samsara, this wheel of cycling through deaths and lives. Did it have any similarities to that idea?
Absolutely. You had to die and you had to feed different parts of nature to revivify, to nurture life, to procure the continuity of life and the world.
So I'm very interested. You said that most of these sacrifices were some form of trying to achieve merit with the gods.
Exactly.
Why would people think that killing another human gave them merit with the gods? Do we know that? I mean, that's getting a little bit beyond what we can find in an archaeological record, I suppose.
Well, we have other sources of information, and it all has to do with the cosmology, with the understanding, with the ideology of Mesoamericans. The idea of their gods as somebody who devours, as somebody who is a predator and has to be satisfied. Quite different from our religious, from the Christian idea, for example, quite different.
I have a question also about how the Mayan people, the various tribes, would see their position in the cosmos. In Western thought, there's this great ladder of being, and humans are at the top, and then animals down, lower and lower life forms. Did the various tribes of Mayans or some of them see themselves as the pinnacle of the gods' work, or did they not have this hierarchical idea?
That's really a good question. In fact, I think the Maya saw themselves in their bodies. And I mean, we have, as a parenthesis, you have to say that the body is not only there, exists not only in its material presence, but there are also life essences, such as the tonal, such as the teolia. These are sorts of souls for us, if we want to simplify that. And these were the light matters. I mean, the breath, the warm breath that you, the beams of vision that they thought were actively kind of hit the objects. And all of that was thought to be divine. So the human body would be seen as a blueprint for the cosmos. The head would be the celestial sphere. There were all also there would be the inner, like the trunk would simulate or be conceived as the sacred mountain, the earth, out of which blood had to be drawn, or the heart that would nurture the remainder of the cosmos. It would be this machine that made the cosmos move. And I think the human body with all its concepts would be in the anchor of that. I would sustain that because it was seen by itself divine, or possessing divine components that were in active exchange with the extrinsic world, not only the terrestrial world, but also the womb of the earth, which we could the underworld, so to speak, and the celestial sphere. So it's part of the whole.
There is a certain beauty and elegance to that idea.
Absolutely, yes. I think it's very, very sophisticated. It's very not only elegant, but very complete, integrated, completely different from our own way of Western thinking, of course.
It's interesting how there are some very striking similarities to old world ideas or other cultural ideas. For example, you read the story in the Hebrew Bible, the tribes of Israel are led out of bondage to the Egyptians, and they go and they commune with God on this mountain. And then God gives them this very detailed legal and ritualistic code. And basically, they start slitting the throats of sheep and twisting the heads off pigeons and sacrificing. And I assume that was also a form of trying to achieve merit with the gods as well.
That's a good parallel, really, yes. Although I think the notion in Christian ideology would be more like of culpability. I think in the Mesoamerican sphere, it's more a notion of merit making. You have a certain debt and you have to pay it off. So it's a different notion, I guess.
Did the Mayans have a concept of sin or of offending the gods?
Of course, but not of sin, probably. It's a different feeling, a different aspect. Of course, now there's an amalgam of ideologies of Christianity and old Mesoamerican traits that you cannot tear apart. But I think it's all part now of the present Native culture and the rich native mosaic that is what is the Maya world now. It's, I think, more alive than ever because, well, more than 1 million, 2 million people still speak Maya and call this their culture, their background, their ideology. Although with the advent of the Spaniards and forced Christianization, these people have been, you know, they have been taken off their old ways in a way that has happened differently from, for example, the Anglo-Saxon colonies. In the U.S., most parts, for example, there hasn't been any compenetration with Indian tribes, for example, the native tribes. Here, there was forced assimilation in place that pretended to make everybody Christian, everybody Hispanic, and try to abolish everything that was not Christian. So there is an active effort that has paid its toll.
So is there a large population that still, and I love this term, that still worships the old gods?
Of course, yes, but it's isolated and it's hidden in many parts. For example, the Chamula Indians in Chiapas, they worship a lot of number of saints and virgins. But each of those stand for a native, for an autochthonous force. So you can see there is a kind of an assimilation, but also a huge, I mean, effort and resilience in modern people to keep with their own ways without compromising, but at the same time being Christian. Paradoxical.
Some of those amalgams are hard for me to parse out, but they make them work. So you told me earlier that you're working on, is it a volume on human sacrifice?
Right now, I am working precisely on Tzompantlis in Mesoamerica. And really what drives my research is not only the Tzompantli, I mean the skull wrecks, but what they stand for. And what I think is there is a renovation, there is a change that comes over Mesoamerica in the ideology, in the cosmology, in the worldviews of Mesoamerica that makes dramatic changes after the fall of Teotihuacan. And I think what we are seeing in those skull wrecks or different sacrificial choreographies that start during the classic, the terminal classic, during the Maya collapse, is exactly that. And that's what drives my research.
So what are these skull racks?
Skull racks unite, they amass human heads that are the result of different forms of sacrifices. And they were symbolizing and representing the sacred mountains, the sacred trees of the Mesoamerican cosmos. They were considered the seeds out of which the world would grow, out of which maize would grow. So they were kept there to make the world function, to vitalize the world.
Now, I've been asking you a lot of questions. Is there anything that you've come across that you find particularly fascinating about the practice of human sacrifice among the Mayan?
I think the extremes are quite breathtaking sometimes to discover and to see in terms of trends, in terms of what they were capable of doing to the ends of feeding different natural forces. And also the changes towards the collapse and after the Maya collapse makes me wonder, what were the changes in religion that brought these new ways of worship? It's like we are seeing Jesus Christ being there, and everywhere at a certain stage there are crosses, and that's what I'm seeing towards the post-classic. We're talking about 800-900, but there are some areas that show this change in religion before, like the Pacific Coast, Veracruz, and I think there's where I would like to see where many of those new ways of those new religious types of worship originated. And that's what I'm looking for.
You're not saying the crosses show up.
No, it's crosses, but we're seeing suddenly check moles. We're seeing the jaguar versus eagle. We're seeing all those serpents. We're seeing crocodiles. We're seeing a sort of worship that was not in place before. And I'm wondering, what brought this about? Is it this a new fifth sun? Is it the new era? What was it that changed all of beyond Mesoamerica? Because we have certain traits of that in Central America and further west and further north. So I'm certain that there is not only an exchange, but like a feedback from across, like that goes much beyond Mesoamerica.
So if there was a new dynasty and a certain set of gods were seen to support the previous dynasty, would the new dynasty bring in new gods, new ways of worship to legitimize their rule?
No, I think there were no dynasties. The dynasties were gone. We have to, we're talking about maybe like 40, 50 linguistic groups. I mean, across the landscape, this was a huge thing that went all over Mesoamerica. So It's something that encompasses much more than just dynasty or just one society.
It's cross different tribes, and it's almost like there's a groundswell instead of a top-down change.
Exactly. Right.
Well, thank you so much. I'm wondering if you could recommend, would any of your works be the most accessible to people who have a fascination with these topics, but maybe not a doctorate-level degree or background in anthropology?
Well, unfortunately, most of my work is in Spanish, so I have a lot of articles out that are for the broad public, but we're talking about Arqueología Mexicana. It has a beautiful set of illustrations and so forth. But in English, I would recommend my book about head shaping. That's edited by Springer, and I think that is quite accessible, so to speak. Different forms of forming the heads of little children.
And you have so many volumes coming out. You have one right now in press at the University of Arizona, I see, before KukulCon.
That was a fun one. Yeah, so, that's out already. Yeah, we did like the population, the human side of one site, and just followed up from there. It was really exciting.
Dr. Tiesler, thank you so much. You've been more than generous with your time.
This is a lot so important because I think the diffusion and, you know, what we work on, and also I think we as academic need to learn how to distribute our work, our ideas much better than we actually do. So this is so useful.
Countering folk anthropology is an important part of your job. All right.
Okay.
Well, thank you very much. I know you've got to run, so I really appreciate it.
Okay. Take care.
You too.